I hope my slides are visible. So good afternoon, good evening to everyone, wherever you are, to this Cake and Pie Expo session of the Vitreoretinal Society of India. We are honored to be here participating in this important surgical topic with a galaxy of speakers from Pakistan and India. The panelists today are President of VRSI, Dr. Shobhit Chawla, the Scientific Committee Convener, Dr. Anand Rajendran, myself, and Dr. Raja Narayanan, the General Secretary. Our moderator is a dynamic surgeon, a very, very renowned surgeon, not just in India, but across the world, Dr. Subhendu Boral from Rishai Hospital in Kolkata. And he will be moderating today's session. The speakers today are Dr. Hussain Khakan from Lahore. He has done his fellowship from Germany, and he is the professor at Lahore General Hospital. He's going to be talking on disasters in cataract surgery. Then we have Dr. Vishal Agarwal. He's also a very, very famous surgeon again. Not just in India, he's also won numerous awards like Dr. Subhendu Boral. He'll be talking to us on different types of glued IOL or sterile IOL. Then we would have Dr. Mudit Tyagi, my colleague here at L.V. Prasada Institute. He's a dynamic and innovative surgeon, numerous innovative techniques, and we'll be talking on glue-assisted retinal detachment surgery with no oil or gas. And then last but not the least, we have Dr. Ritesh Narula, also a former fellow at L.V. Prasada Institute. Now he's a senior consultant at Center for Sight in Delhi, and he'll be talking to us on COVID-19 and its complications. I now hand over to Dr. Subhendu Boral for the proceedings.
So, welcome everybody. So, I'm just without any delay, I'm just starting our session with Professor Dr. Hussain Ahmed Khakan from Pakistan, as a very well known VR surgeon, presently associated associate professor Lahore General Hospital. As also, he's the visiting consultant in Shaukat Khanum Cancer Hospital in Lahore. He is having more than 19 years of experience in the field of wear, as well as glaucoma, brow implant, and strabismus surgery. He is a versatile surgeon. So, welcome, sir. So, your topic: disasters in cataract surgery, retinal surgeons to rescue. Dr. Hussain, sir, please start your session.
Yes. So, thank you, Vitreoretinal Society of India, for inviting me, and thank you, Dr. Shabir, Dr. Raja, and Dr. Subhendru for all these efforts. I am really grateful and hope in future we will see in person, and that will be an honor for me and for my colleagues. So I am talking about disasters in cataract surgery, retinal surgeon to the rescue. So I have a few cases to share. I will like to input of my seniors and my colleagues. So my first case is about, I will show a few cases about dropped IOL and their management. So my first case is here. You can see a aphakic eye with has little bit of capsule sulcus. I am using 23 gauge pars plana vitrectomy system. And here you can see a dropped IOL with three prangs, and it's lying over the macular area. So after doing the core vitrectomy, I am just releasing it from the vitreous so it may get mobile, and maybe I get a little bit away from the macular area. So just holding, and then I planned with hand grasping forceps to hold its one haptic, and just holding it and bringing it into the interior chamber. It was a little bit difficult because it's an old model of intraocular lens, and his three prongs were having difficulty, and I didn't want to lose the capsular rim while removing this intraocular lens. So then I holding with the hand grasping forceps and cutting this intraocular lens in the interior chamber with simple use on a scissor. If you have few lens cutting scissor, you can use this one. The cautious is that you are using Helon or Viscor, while doing this maneuver. And then lens have been divided into the two parts. And then you can remove it easily from the small 2.75 wound. Reposition of the RS, and then I am planting multi-piece foldable lens. And just you just inject it over in the interior chamber, and then with the dialer you can easily place it over the sulcus area. So I just use it, and here you can see at the end lens is well centered and pupil is round, and hopefully things are good in this scenario. So now I am going to share my second case. So here you can see once again, it's an aphakic eye, and I'm using 23 gauge vitrectomy system, and the lens is dropped, and it is a foldable lens we usually use in routine. So similar principle, left free the vitreous from the lens. Around the lens, I am doing cord vitrectomy just to make it mobile. You can see the flickering movement, and then with the simple and grasping forceps, I am holding the one haptic of the dropped intraocular lens. So here you can see I am same technique. I'm just bringing it inside anterior chamber, and I am doing the hand sharing technique while using the two and grasping forceps. So this in this case, I have a little bit enlarged the wound. I didn't cut the lens. And then I am planting 5.5 millimeter rigid lens on the sulcus area. So in first case, I showed the foldable re-implantation of the lens after removal. Here, I am removing the foldable lens and just implanting the 5.5 optics lens, rigid lens in the sulcus area. So at the end of the surgery, the pupil is round, and you can see lens is well centered. So if in first case, I showed the re-implantation of the foldable lens. Second case, I showed the re-implantation of rigid lens. Now I'm showing the removal of the intraocular lens and refixation of the same lens without removing with the scleral sutures. So this is dropped rigid IOL. So similar technique, I am going for the vitrectomy, core vitrectomy, relatively free the vitreous. Then I am lifting from the one haptic and bringing it to the anterior chamber. I'm using hand sharing technique, and it was a bit difficult to bring it out from the posterior chamber to the anterior chamber. So the similar technique, I brought it into the anterior chamber and put it in front of the iris. So I didn't want to remove this lens. So I plan to do the scleral fixation of the same lens with the 10-0 proline. So here the technique is basically very simple, as most of us do, and you people know it very well. So I am just using the bent needle with the proline suture, but I am not making an additional ports into the limbal area or in the corneal wound. I am using one port, bringing this suture out. And then I'm bringing the haptic out with this suture. I am tying the haptic of the proline, and then I'm rotating it to towards the 6 o'clock. Suture is tied with it, proline. I'm taking it to the behind the iris. Now I am bringing out the second haptic. similar way proline suture, bringing it out from the same limbal wound. I am tying with the proline. This is the haptic that will be fixed about at 12 o'clock. Then pushing it behind the iris and just centralization of the intraocular lens as we usually do in scleral fixation, sutured scleral fixation of the IOL. And at the end, you can see it's centered little bit, iris is distorted due to the maneuver. At the end, it was quite nice to be centered. So these were the few cases. I have a few more cases, but due to the time constraint, I wouldn't show those other techniques of IOL removal and replacement. And now I switch to my second topic, that is about the drop nucleus. There are a lot of variants of drop nucleus and management. I will just show very basic two or three techniques. So here is the case. It's basically whole lens is dropped. It is just microspherophakic lens. It's a rare condition that we usually encounter, but in phaco area, we see a lot of drop nucleus. So I just wanted to show this for the audience. So you may encounter such conditions. So these lenses are microspherophakic and not much rigidity in it, but you can easily do phaco fragmentation with the cutter. Just you have to puncture the capsule and then with the light pipe and the help of the cutter, you can easily chew these soft lenses in microspherophakic eyes. So that's one variant of removing the dislocated cataractous microspheric lens. So then you can complete your vitrectomy. This is the routine case as we see in the cases of drop nucleus. This is hypermature white cataract drop during the phacoemulsification. Here I'm doing the core vitrectomy with a 23 gauge vitrectomy system. So you can see it's a large nucleus. It's not possible to cut with a 23 gauge cutter because cortical matter was a little bit and it was soft. I removed it. Then I introduced the phacofragmatome and just brought it into the mid vitreous cavity and few punches that would deal with this hard cataract. So here you can see the hard cataract. You can easily take it with the phacofragmatome. So you have to enlarge a little bit of your sclerostomy port. And at the end, the last piece has been chewed with it. There's one more case I just wanted to show. The phaco case complicated and there's a lot of anterior segment lens matter. So that has been cut through the pars plana approach. And then if you go behind, there's a soft lens matter relatively lying in the mid vitreous cavity. When I try to cut it, it's just dropped on the retina. So it's not hard enough. It's just a soft cataractous lens, cortical matter. So you can easily chop with the help of the cutter and just trim it little size. And then you can easily remove this soft cortical lens matter in these cases. Hello.
Hello. Yes.
Yes, Judge. His screen is stuck here.
Is it working?
It's not working.
Your next slide, the surgery is still having some steps.
It's stuck.
No matter. You can show your next slide also. If this video is having some problem,
I will switch on to my third topic. Enough. Sorry for interruption. It's just stuck due to the one or other reason. So that was the few cases where I managed the microspheric lens and dropped mature cataract. And then I showed you the few cortical lens matter pieces that has been dropped and interior chamber lens matter. So now I'm going to show the third portion of my presentation, that is about the end of thermitis after the cataract surgery. So here you can see a case of post-cataract surgery, end of thermitis, a lot of exudation in the anterior chamber. So I just using Simco cannula to remove the exudation and hypopyon from the anterior chamber. So it's a pseudophakic eye. Pupil is not widely dilated. As you know, most of these cases, pupil is difficult to dilate. So what I started with the core vitrectomy. I used the best illumination system that I had available. So you can see much exudation over the retinal area. The view is not much clearer in the video because the pupil was not much dilated due to the end of thermitis and cornea was edematous due to the inflammation. So in these eyes, you can see, you know, all of you, that the things are not very easy to visualize. I am using usually IBOS visual system. So I am doing core vitrectomy, then removing the exudative membranes from the retina. My preference is that to remove the exudative membrane, we need to use the back flush needle rather than to use the vacuum of the cutter, because it may pull the retina, and the retina is fragile and it is ischemic. So we may have iatrogenic breaks and may even create a giant retinal tear. So at the end of the surgery, you can see a few oozing vessels and the retina is relatively clear. I prefer to remove all the exudative membranes from the posterior pole. And at the end of the surgery, I have to put the oil inside the eye, and you see disc is relatively healthy and macula is fine in this case, in the case of end of thermitis. So I will show one other case. This is the second case of end of thermitis. It was relatively a week older, and then the similar principle, I use the Simco cannula to remove the exudation from the anterior chamber. So first I started with the core vitrectomy. The exudation from the mid vitreous cavity was removed. You can see that this floating exudative membranes. And few exudations lying over the retina. The principle is the same. I do the core vitrectomy, then I have to remove the membranes. I usually use the extrusion or back flush needle to separate these membranes from the retina. And then I have to inject oil in these eyes because we had a bad experience of old endophthalmitis, chronic endophthalmitis cases, that these cases usually re-detach after the vitrectomy and leaving the BSS inside the eye. So I do the laser and just put the oil, and then I remove the oil within 3 months. So this is the second case of endophthalmitis. You can see relatively healthy retina and good outcomes after the surgery. Now I'm showing my last case of endophthalmitis. Here you can see a dense exudative membrane involving the pupillary area. I tried to remove with the Simco cannula, but couldn't. Then I used the end grasping forceps to remove the exudative membrane from the pupillary area. Then things were a little bit clearer. Then I have to remove the exudative membrane behind the lens. And you see that there is a not very good clear view due to a lot of membranes in the vitreous and hazy cornea, small pupil, as all the difficulties we face during the management of endophthalmitis cases. So I'm just removing the cortical vitreous, and then I try to remove not much from the base. You can just remove the needy vitreous that may be in your view, but not much the base shape. So I'm just removing the much exudation from the interior retina. So here you see, as I am doing cutting more and more, there is a better visualization of the retina and better visualization of the optic disc. Now I am removing the exudation from the inferior retina with the cutter. It's sometimes very easy to remove these exudation and membrane with the cutter, but sometimes these are very sticky on the retina. You cannot remove it with the cutter. Even when you try to pull it, the retina starts bleeding. At the end, the eye exchange, air fluid, oil exchange, and the eye behaved very well in the near future for the saving of the eye globe and VN to the some extent in these cases. So that's all my presentation. If I have took few minutes more, my apologies. And if you have any question, we can discuss it all. Thank you so much for kind attention. And thank you VRSI and the Expo for inviting me.
Thank you, Dr. Hussain, for your nice and very dynamic surgical steps. And we will come to the questions later on. Now I invite Dr. Mudit Tyagi, who is he's the head of department UVA Ocular Immunology at L.P. Prasad Eye Institute, Hyderabad. And his topic is no oil, no gas, glue assisted retinal detachment surgery. He's a very innovative and dynamic surgeon, Dr. Mudit.
All right, so are my slides visible?
Yes, your slides
are visible. All right, so first of all, thanks to the Media Mice group and VRSI for giving me this chance to speak upon this topic. And thanks to Dr. Boral for his kind introduction. So I'll be talking about a vitreoretinal surgery technique, which basically spares us the use of oil or gas. And I don't have any financial disclosures. So if you look at it conventionally, the ways of treating a retinal detachment have been either a scleral buckling or a pars plana vitrectomy or a pneumatic retinopexy. Now, over times in the last few years, there has been an increasing tilt towards pars plana vitrectomy as one of our primary modalities for dealing with the retinogenous retinal detachments. In fact, one of the practice intent surveys of ASRS also showed that there's an increased prevalence and increased tilt towards use of vitrectomy for retinogenous retinal detachments. However, the problem over here is that we end up using tamponade agents, which can either be oil or gas, and they come with their own set of problems. We need to give postoperative positioning to all of our patients. There is a concern for glaucoma, corneal changes, and cataract. There can be re-detachment after oil removal, postoperative hypotony, repeat surgeries, a restriction in air travel if you put gas inside the eye, and more importantly, a delayed visual recovery till the time you either remove oil or till the time the gas bubble gets dissipated. So then we thought, what can we do possibly to remove these problems which come with a conventional tamponade? Now, if you look at it historically, the word tamponade comes from the word tampon, which means to plug. And essentially, tamponade agents are the ones which are used to provide surface tension across breaks in order to prevent further fluid flow into the subretinal space till the effect of a retinopexy, which may be of laser photocoagulation or cryopexy, becomes permanent. And we do know that adhesion strength of almost 95% is achieved at around 18 hours after photocoagulation. And we get a maximum strength of around day 5. So that means we need a tamponade agent which can prevent fluid from going into the subretinal space till the time the effect of our pexy becomes permanent. So we thought, why don't we utilize some other agent? And we thought of fibrin glue. Now, fibrin glue is a mixture of eprotinin, fibronectin, and plasminogen. And already it has been used extensively in ophthalmology, in ocular surface procedures, in scleral fixation of intraocular lenses, and even in retinal procedures like optic disc pit associated maculopathies and in macular holes. We already have had studies which have shown its safety as far as retina is concerned, and animal studies have shown it to be non-toxic to RPE. Like I said, it's already been used earlier in optic disc pit associated macular detachments and even in macular holes. So we have an agent which is essentially safe to use in retina. So this is the surgical technique which we had thought of. So if you have an RD, this is a schematic to explain that technique. You have an RD with an inferior break. What you do is, after a conventional complete pass plan of vitrectomy in an air-filled globe, we do a laser around the retinal break. And subsequently, in an air-filled globe, you put a drop of fibrin glue to cover the break. So the glue basically acts as a plug to tamponade or to close the break. So we are doing absolutely all the steps which we would have otherwise done in a vitrectomy. But at the end of the surgery, instead of putting oil or gas, what we are using is, we are using a blob of fibrin to cover the break. And let me show this in our surgical video. And we did not give any post-operative positioning to our patients. So this is a surgical technique. We've got an RD with an inferior break over here. And you do a complete, thorough, extensive vitrectomy to ensure that there is no vitreous which is left around the break.
The break was marked by diathermy.
After marking the break with a diathermy,
and subsequently,
a fluid air exchange is done.
Was done. The retina was settled and endolaser was done around the break.
So after settling the retina, you can do a laser around the break. And so we have done a laser over here to cover the entire break. And then,
after this, in an air-filled globe, fibrin glue was injected over the break. Care was taken to inject the thicker component of fibrin glue initially, followed by the thinner one.
So what we do is, we apply fibrin glue over it, and after waiting for 5 minutes,
fibrin glue coagulum forms in 5 minutes. Flute needle was used to reposition the coagulum over the break so as to cover it completely.
So this coagulum can be very easily lifted either with the forceps or with a fluid needle, and you just need to roll it back and cover the break over it. So at the end of the surgery, you've got a completely attached retina.
To use the fibrin glue plug to cover the break and prevent further fluid flow into the subretinal space till the effect of the laser retinopexy becomes permanent. At the end of the surgery, balanced salt solution was swished on and air was removed.
So we removed the entire air and we just left the eye under fluid. And this is the first post-operative day look of the globe, where you can see an attached retina. And you see this fibrin coagulum plug covering the break. So this is how the case evolved. Patient in an RD inferiorly, first post-operative day, you see this fibrin plug covering the break. And at the end of 2 weeks, the entire fibrin glue gets resolved by itself, leaving behind an attached retina with the surrounding laser marks. Now, how do we apply the glue? You can either use it manually, but we have found a better way where you can use this MedOne or microdose injection kit, which was initially planned to inject subretinal TPA, but you can use the same thing, attach it to your vitrectomy system, and with the help of a foot switch through a VFC, you can just connect it and apply glue in a very controlled way. The idea is also to put the thicker component first and then the thin one, so as to prevent the subretinal migration. So let me show you how to apply the glue. So this is another case with an inferior RD with the help of your MedOne injection kit attached to the VFC control. Very nicely, you can just put one drop each of thick and thin component. Wait for 5 minutes and then you see this coagulum is formed. And then all you need to do is just lift it. So here I'm using a forceps to just lift it and just completely cover the break over here with the fibrin coagulum. So these are some of my other cases. This was another patient who had an inferior RD, and then you can see breaks even temporally. And at 1 month, 3 months and 6 months, this is a 6 month follow-up of a patient where you can see all of the glue goes away. The glue essentially gets absorbed within 14 days. One of the rare complications which can occur is that there can be a small subretinal migration of the glue, but that also gets absorbed within next 10 to 14 days and does not leave behind any sequelae. So this was one patient who had an inferior RD, and then you can see initially there is a small area of subretinal fibrin, but at the end of 1 week, that entire subretinal fibrin is regressed. And at 2 weeks, you can see that everything has gone away and you've got an attached retina with inferior surrounding laser marks. So we have till now done it in more than 30 cases, and only 3 eyes had an increased post-operative inflammation, which was not significant and something which we could manage with just topical prednisolone eye drops given every 2 hourly for 1 week. None of the eyes had any elevation of intraocular pressure. 7 eyes did have a subretinal migration like what I had shown, but that resolved spontaneously by 2 weeks. two of our cases had a cystoid macular edema, but then mind you, both of these cases had also gone a complicated cataract surgery where there was a PC dehiscence and a PCI evil which had been inserted. So whether I can attribute it to the complication of glue usage or whether it was a pre-existing pseudophakic macular edema is difficult to comment upon. But the point is that just by using nepafenac eye drops, the CME also had regressed. So in the end, fibrin glue tends to resolve at the end of 2 weeks, a time which we believe is sufficient while the adhesive forces of laser photocoagulation set in. We do not have to resort to give any postoperative positioning to any of our patients. And thus, fibrin glue-assisted surgery is a promising technique for treatment of simple, uncomplicated dermatogenous RDs. It provides us a very early visual recovery. We do not have to give any postoperative positioning to our patients, and it avoids most of the usual pitfalls which we face with the gas or an oil tamponade. And with that, I would just like to acknowledge the help of some of my senior colleagues, Dr. Sangwan and Dr. Basu from the cornea services, and my retina colleagues, Dr. J. Chablani, Dr. Narayanan, Dr. Rajiv, Dr. Das, and some of my other colleagues and friends who were a sounding board with whom I used to discuss these ideas. And finally, a word of acknowledgement to all our patients who are the reason why we are vitreoretinal surgeons in the first place. So thank you. And with that, I'll stop my slide and I'm open for any further questions. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Mudit, for your nice and very innovative talk. So I'll go to our next speaker, Dr. Ritesh Narula. He's a senior wear surgeon, Center for Sight, New Delhi. He has been 13 years of experience in wear field, involved also in wear training, and invited guest speaker as well as instructor in various national and international forums. Many have many publications, and most importantly, is in the core group of Delhi Retinomy. So I'm inviting Dr. Ritesh Narula for his talk, COVID-19 and the retina and complications of COVID-19.
Thank you, Dr. Boran. I'll be sharing my screen, sir. Am I visible?
Visible.
Very good evening to all of you. I would at the outset like to thank VRSI for giving me this opportunity to present at such a great meeting. Thank you, MediaMice, for giving me this platform to showcase my work. I'll be talking about COVID-19 and the retinal issues that we are seeing with COVID-19. Last year has been a bit of a challenge for all of us. We have been fighting this COVID-19 pandemic, and with this adversity comes a lot of things to learn. And this is such an entity wherein we still do not know the full spectrum what all this disease can cause. A lot of things are still getting unraveled as we continue to fight out this pandemic. Going with the same thought, same flow, there has been a lot of data boom which has happened over the last 1 year, and there have been about 150 plus publications on ophthalmic manifestations of COVID-19, out of which 1/4 do talk about retinal issues associated with the disease. Now, one has to understand most of these publications are associations which have been seen with COVID-19 with a multitude of presentations. There have been a few theories of pathogenesis, but very few true associations with the SARS coronavirus 2 has been established. So these are just a full gamut of, at the moment we are at a stage, we are just looking at what all possible things can be seen with COVID-19. To kind of collect all this data COVID-19 and the eye, Indian Journal of Ophthalmology, there was a review which was published this year, wherein they divided the posterior segment involvement between neuronal, vascular, and the inflammatory. And they basically said that most of these patients were of the age group between 17 and 75 with a mean age of about 47.5. And the duration of presentation varied from as less as 4 days to about 55 days post COVID-19. And these are the kind of cases which have been reported through this review, starting from CRVO, CRU to going to as severe as endophthalmitis. Interestingly, if you look at the time frame of the COVID, patient having COVID disease and when he developed those retinal conditions, most of the retinal involvement that was seen post-COVID were either subacute or delayed in onset. So it's not as if the patient was having all this during or initial stage of fighting with COVID. They presented even after discharge or after he had recovered from COVID. So we have, I have classified our set of patients into again three categories: the neuronal, the vascular, and the opportunistic. The neuronal ones, which we thought were the direct effect of the viruses, the vascular one, which are attributable to the hypercoagulable state created by this COVID-19 virus, and the opportunistic infections because of the suppressed immunity caused during this disease. We also conducted a retrospective review of all our cases in the last 1 year. We have had 20 such eyes in which the patient had COVID-19 RT-PCR positive post COVID-19, varying from days to weeks after COVID, they presented to us with retinal manifestations and a detailed systemic workup, to best of our knowledge, was negative for other causes of that particular event that we were seeing. So first I would begin with the direct neuronal effect. This direct neuronal effect was first reported in Lancet 2020, wherein they showed that COVID-19 is causing these hyperreflective lesions at the level of the ganglion cell and the inner plexiform layer. They were cotton wool spots, subtle microhemorrhages, while the visual acuity and the pupils were staying normal in these eyes. There were other reports which talked about nerve fiber layer infarcts and microhemorrhages in the papillomacular bundle. These were all attributed to the direct virus infiltrating the retina and causing these neuronal changes directly by the virus itself. We have not seen any of the cases from this particular category of manifestation of COVID. This is reported in literature, though there was a lot of debate on this, whether it was actually there or not. I could mentally, when I was going through this literature, I could correlate with some of the findings similar to what we used to see when dengue and chikungunya virus retinitis were reported, kind of similarity to those virus infections causing on the retina, which was being reported here with COVID-19. Going to the second category, wherein it is the vascular changes, which is associated with COVID-19 associated coagulopathy. We have all been aware now that COVID-19 is causing a lot of venous, arterial, and microcirculatory coagulopathy changes, which are quite multifactorial in origin. There has been systemic vasculitis also reported, especially in the brain with COVID-19. And this all has been thought to be because of the type 3 hypersensitivity reaction to this immune complex disease caused by COVID-19, which triggers this inflammatory response during the cytokine storm phase. One of the publications from Dr. Rajanarayanan and his colleagues, which talked about seeing the inflammatory vein occlusion and retinal vasculitic changes during the cytokine storm patients, cytokine storm phase of a COVID-19 patient. We also saw a patient, a 40-year-old male, presenting to us with about 6-9 vision, just recovered from a moderate COVID-19 disease. And he had frank vasculitis with an inflammatory DRVO kind of a picture. Detailed workup for all possible primary and secondary likely investigations were all negative for any etiology. Also, COVID-19 pneumonia has been associated with presence of bilateral CRV in the literature. This is again attributable either to the inflammatory causes or because of the coagulopathy caused by the disease. There have been bilateral CRV reported due to the thromboembolic process, that as per this paper from Dr. Natarajan's group. We also had our share of patients with presenting with massive CRVO immediately post recovery from COVID. This was a patient who came to us 2 days after discharge from the hospital with a florid CRVO in one eye. There have been subtle signs also. Not all have presented with such massive cases. There had been this 45-year-old female patient who had this mild kind of inflammatory event happening in the inferior veins, a cotton wool spot, had a spontaneous resolution post-COVID. We had a patient who had a kind of a venous stasis kind of a picture with bilateral dilated vascular networks. On OCT, we and on Opta, we had done an Opta also for her later. We had a suspicion that probably there was an increase in the middle layer thickness here, probably a associated PAM along with the venous stasis happening in this eye. To the other end, we had the severe kind of a picture. This was a patient who had a CRVO with severe retinal artery occlusion. There was a patient who had CRVO with branch retinal artery occlusion. Both these patients then spontaneously, over a period of time, resolved the lesions on the retina, resolved with visual effects and the retinal changes as seen here. Bilateral CRAO has been reported from COVID-19 in literature also from Dr. Bapai's group. This was again a patient who had a PL vision 2 weeks post COVID-19, attributed again to the thromboembolic phenomena associated with COVID disease. Coming to the third part of the manifestation, which is the opportunistic infections, it is said that COVID-19 causes a significant decrease in the immunity of the patients, secondary to the decrease in the CD4 counts, decrease in the lymphocytes. Also, all these patients are on intravenous corticosteroid, which is essentially a life-saving option in these cases. This further worsens an already compromised immune system. Both these factors predispose this patient to opportunistic infections. There's enough evidence to support this decreased immunity and opportunistic infection. Last month or so in India, especially around Delhi, we have had this kind of an epidemic of mucormycosis, wherein patients have come recovered from COVID, who were diabetics, had been on steroid for a long period of time, presenting with severe mucor infections in sinuses, orbit, and cause a lot of stress and a lot of morbidity in these cases. Coming to our work here, this is a paper we have, which is coming out in this issue of IGO. It's a joint publication with Center for Sight and Shroff Eye Center, wherein we are reporting about 7 eyes of 5 patients who presented with endogenous fungal endophthalmitis following intensive corticosteroid therapy. All these patients had recovered from COVID-19 pneumonia and had received steroids. But interesting here was all of them had taken steroids for a very long period of time. They were all having been given steroids for an average in about 42 days. The range was 18 to 1 patient actually getting steroids for almost like 80 days. And they all presented initially with mild symptoms such as floaters, and the average onset was from day 1 to day 14 after discharge. Initially, they had all been picked up as non-infectious uveitis, wherein they were steroids were pumped up. And eventually, they had endogenous endophthalmitis, and out of these, 5 eyes grew candida species, grew fungus, 4 had candida and 1 had aspergillus on growth. I'll share you one of my index cases, the first case that we picked up. This was on 25th July last year, a 30-year-old male who presented to us after recovering from COVID-19, and he had been there on non-invasive ventilator and steroids for almost like 14 days. And he had again been diagnosed as chorioretinitis and had been given steroids. He had a visual acuity of 636 and 624. And this was his fundus lesion. He had both eyes had this small yellowish round lesion close to a vessel with a small breakthrough hemorrhage in the left eye, mild vitreous haze there. A detailed systemic workup to look for the source of infection and for other causes was normal. And by the time we were investigating and trying to understand what we were dealing with here, because this was first case we were seeing, the lesion started to worsen, the vision in the left eye dropped further down. And now when we look at the right left eye fundus, you could nicely see those strands and the ring of pearl appearance. Strong suspicion of fungus herein was there in our mind. We took the patient up for vitreous biopsy. It came out to be candida. And subsequently, in spite of intravitreal, the patient was worsening. Intravitreals are given for both eyes. And eventually, we had to do a vitrectomy with oil. And over a period of last 1 year fighting this endophthalmitis, the patient has undergone, one eye has undergone oil removal. One eye has recovered to 6.9N8. The other is still maintaining 636 N24 because of this dense scar sitting on the disc. Apart from this, the other manifestations that we could pick up, patient had these subtle yellowish deposits on the retina to as severe as this large retinal abscess seen in this patient of ours. And the patient underwent vitrectomy in all these cases, and we were able to salvage these eyes. And this is not just the only report. there were other reports of fungal endophthalmitis. Earlier, it was presumed to be endogenous endophthalmitis from Dr. Venkatramani's group. They did not have any culture-proven infections, but the lesions were very similar to what we saw in our case series. Reports of candida retinitis have also come up on publications. A very interesting patient here, a 60-year-old female post-COVID who developed mucormycosis, came to us with decreased vision, and she had orbital mucormycosis, the sinuses were full, and she had this large subretinal abscess. Currently, she is on treatment for mucormycosis. Are we dealing with a subretinal mucormycosis abscess here? We don't have a definitive proof here, but yeah, that's the pathology which is happening in that eye and that orbit there. To end the talk, I would just leave you with a small red herring. There have been case reports of patients with mucormycosis in retina presenting with CRAO. So in the current COVID times, a CRAO, if we see as the first presentation also, especially true for mucormycosis coming close to the orbital apex. And this is interestingly shown in one of the reports here. So that is the whole gamut of cases that we have been seeing over the last 1 year. So my take-home message here is that retinal involvement following COVID-19, though may be rare, but it's important to be aware of the spectrum that we can possibly see. Fundus examination post-COVID-19 should be encouraged, especially in patients who have been on prolonged steroids and who complain of certain visual symptoms like blurring, floaters. And those steroids are very important as a life-saving measure. One needs to be careful how much and how much steroid is being given. And also, these cases present quite slowly and with a delay in diagnosis. So one has to be aware about these so that we do not give them over steroid and misdiagnose them as inflammatory pathologies. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Dr. Nitesh, for your nice compilation of all critical cases. Now, without any delay, I will come to our last speaker, Dr. Vishal Agarwal, who is MD from All India Institute of Medical Science, FRCS, as well as fellow Sankarnathalaya, presently the professor, SMS Medical College, Jaipur. Own many words in India, CSSME, and out international, Euretina, Best Video Award, as well as ASRS Image Competition, and a lot of other awards in the state, as well as in national level. His topic is All Roads Leads to Rome, Various Ways and Techniques of Applying Blue Eyewear.
Thank you, sir. Can you see my slides?
Yes, it's visible.
Okay, so thank you, VRSI and the Media Mice Group, for having me here. And I'll be speaking on the different ways of doing a sutureless IOL in complicated cases, and also the routine techniques as we practice them. So just a short brief, the best place we all know for an IOL is the capsular bag. But we also know that in the best of hands, intraoperative complications do occur, and there are cases of subluxated lenses, IOLs, and congenital conditions which can lead to insufficient capsular bag support. And historically, we all used to do AC IOLs, and after that came the sutured SF IOL, which have been the mainstay of treatment. Since then, secondary IOL implantation has come a long way from the sutured SF IOL to glued IOL. Pioneerized by Dr. Agarwal's group in 2008, and after that now Yamane technique and other modifications of the same technique which are in practice today. So I'll be coming to the videos directly, and this was a case of subluxated IOL, as you can see here, with the retinal detachment. So we plan to do IOL refixation and detachment surgery in the same setting. And in the glued IOL technique, what is important is that you do a limited peritomy at 6 o'clock and 9 o'clock, and the marking is very important. It has to be exactly 180 degree apart, and you can use that arcing marker for that. And then you make a 2.5 into 2.5 scleral flaps at opposite ends, and they should not be flimsy. They should be deep enough and wide enough. So after making this flap, as you can see, it has been freshened with a crescent knife and a scissors. And then, this is a sherrier tunnel, which I'm making with a 26 gauge needle, which is at the edge of the of of the bed of the flap. And you can always, you know, use a trypan blue to, you know, inject a slight amount into it, so you can identify while inserting the haptic. It's not very easy to identify without a dye. So you can do one thing that you can color it with a trypan blue drop. And after that, you make a 23 gauge or 25 gauge stab incision. And then with the 23 or 25 gauge end gripping forceps, you extrude the haptic, like in this case. And then, you know, with a dialer, you take the haptic into the EC and extrude the other haptic with the handshake technique, putting a lot of visco, of course, in the anterior chamber. And then in here, I'm inserting the haptic inside the Charrier tunnel. And this is a very important step because it has to be deep enough and it should be long enough for ensuring the stability. So you can either use the fibrin glue for the flap bed, or you can, you know, just suture it with the 10-0 or a vicryl suture. That does not matter. But the main point here is it's an excellent and elegant technique with a very low incidence of IOL tilt. And the stability of the IOL is extremely stable, especially in patients which are not very high myopic. And as you can see in this patient, we proceeded to a full vitrectomy for a RD. And in the end of the procedure also, the IOL was absolutely stable and we had no problem in completing the procedure. So this is one of my earlier cases in 2012 or 13, I think. And in this, I just wanted to share some of the things we should not do while doing a glued IOL. See, the flaps are not very nicely fashioned. They are flimsy. And after fashioning the Charrier tunnel, now I'm entering the eye. And you can see that here, I've entered a little bit anterior. So my instruments are, you know, shearing upon the iris root, and that can lead to, you know, sometimes either to dialysis also and some pricked blade in the posterior chamber. So it should be around 2 mm so that it does not touch the iris root. And I use the same port to, you know, lift up the IOL, which was dislocated in this case, with the end gripping forceps. And now I'm using the handshake technique, you know, to extrude the haptic. And this is one more thing I would not like to advise for the newcomer, for the juniors who are, you know, starting this technique, that it should be all under control and these IOLs should not be hanging in the vitreous cavity like this. This was one of my initial cases and, you know, I learned a lot from this case. And it should not be a pull like here, I'm, you know, pulling the haptic. Fortunately, I got through this case safely without any complications, but you can end up, you know, tilting the IOL, you can end up in, you know, breaking the haptic. And you can always, you know, if the IOL is hanging like this, you can always have injuries in the posterior pole or in the retina with peripheral retinal breaks. So again, then we have the whole, both the haptics were extrudized and they were, you know, tucked in the Charrier tunnel, and then the flaps were closed. Unfortunately, the case went well. But just in case, you know, you needed some feedback of what not to do in glued IOL, this was the case for it. So the last glued IOL I personally did was in 2017 late. And after that, I've been doing the M&A method and the original M&A method. And finally, the improvisation, which we now do. So first, I'll be discussing a few, you know, clips of what not to do and what mistakes I did. So here you can see I made a marking at 90 and 180 degree. And this is a three-piece IOL being injected in the anterior chamber. Now I'm making a intrascular tunnel via 26 gauge needle. And now I have a 20 degree angulation and I'm inserting into the vitreous cavity, turning it perpendicular. Now you can see the mark is here, approximately here. And I've inserted it way too early into that, inside the vitreous cavity. Now what it does is, in the initial part where the leading haptic is railroaded into the needle, it does not cause any problem. But the problem is the asymmetry and the other asymmetry on the other side. So when you are tucking the second haptic, the trailing haptic into the needle tip, then the, you know, whole globe gets twisted and it's very difficult, you know, for the tip to go inside. See, I'm having a lot of difficulty in the tip going inside the second needle. So that would have been better if I had, you know, further proceeded the first needle into the tunnel and then gone into the vitreous cavity. So it has to be a long tunnel till the mark and then go perpendicular to the vitreous cavity. The other is the maneuvering parts. So the original Yamane technique, you know, tells you to simultaneously withdraw the haptics. And sometimes, you know, you have an asymmetrical pull and that can lead to, you know, a breakage of haptic. Like in this case, as you can see, the IOL is in the interior chamber. And the first leading haptic is being, you know, railroaded into the needle. And the second now is being done. And see, I'm pulling it a lot more than what is required. And I'm not taking, observing the second, the original, the leading haptic. And this has led to the, you know, broken haptic, which, you know, comes out from this area. And then we had to eventually explant the IOL and put a new three-piece IOL for the Yamane technique. So you should not, you know, pull excessively. These IOLs are very good, but excessive pressure can lead to haptic breakage. So this is the technique now, what we have modified for our own comfort and works beautifully is that modified Yamane technique. And I'll just show you the steps which we do routinely, and it's a reproducible and a very good way of doing it, because Yamane technique, you know, has a learning curve. So what we do is first make a marking with our RK marker, 2 mm posterior to it limbus, and another 2 mm from that initial mark to mark the skeletal tunnel. Then we go deep into the sclera, first with a 20 degree angulation and then with a 5 degree angulation into the vitreous cavity. That's a very important step, you know, to ensure the stability of the IOL. Sorry. The same thing is done on the other side, the opposite end. You go inside the sclera deep till the first mark and then go down. The second step here is that we are, you know, injecting with the three-piece IOL and directly, you know, feeding the leading haptic into the needle. So you don't open it into the interior chamber. You directly feed the first leading haptic into the needle and exteriorize it first. So here the leading haptic is exteriorized outside and the trailing haptic is near the wound, and which is then handshaken with the other forceps, and then it is fed into the second needle and then removed consequently. So here we are removing the haptics consequently, not simultaneously. So that gives you a more control over the technique. You hold, of course, have to hold the first haptic, otherwise it will go into the vitreous cavity. So here the IOL is now centered and you just make a flange for the haptic and, you know, tuck it subconjunctively into the scleral tunnel. It holds well. So there are many modifications, you know, available in literature of the Yamane technique. So you have to improvise on your own. But the main points are that... a couple of slides more. So the marking should be 180 degree opposite. If the corneal diameter is more, then you can make an oblique marking. And the flange making is by a low, you know, temperature cautery. But we have now published that you can make the flange with a laser probe also, and with a heated 24 gauge needle tip also. So these are ways of doing Yamane technique. This was the publication in IGO where we, you know, told indigenous ways of, you know, making the flange in the Yamane technique. I'll be skipping that. So sutureless fixation techniques are the future of secondary IOLs, and of course, reduced morbidity, decreased operative time, and excellent long-term safety are the major advantages. Of course, a definite learning curve, more so in the Yamane technique, is present. So younger surgeons should have a backup plan like ACIUL for their initial cases. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Vishal. There is a question in the question answer box that how will you calculate the IUL power when the retina is detached?
If the retina is detached.
When the retina is detached, how will you calculate the IUL power for SFIUL? in a detached.
So if the eye is, you know, actually for the secondary IOL, if the eye is highly myopic, I prefer to calculate the sulcus power. If it is hypermetropic or an emmetropic eye, the back power suffices in these cases.
Okay.
But per se, if you are talking of IOL calculation in RDIs, then I prefer to do it under OIL when I'm doing SOR and cataract together with the optical biometry system.
No. When the retina is like dropped IOL and detached retina, when you are removing the IOL and putting the SFIL, and as well as you are settling the detachment.
So, sir, that would be cases, a dicey situation. And in that case, I would try to remove the IOL and attach the retina and put a secondary IOL during SOR.
Okay. Thank you. So, now coming to the questions, for any questions for Dr. Hussain?
Dr. Hussain, whether you, in all your endophthalmitis cases, whether you regularly put in oil for almost all the cases, because most of the cases we're already putting in oil.
That was my question also.
Yeah, and secondarily, when you do your the grab of the dropped IOL on the retinal surface with the engrasping forceps, do you it without PFCL aid, or do you sometimes prefer to put in a PFCL? Because very often, if it's on the macula, that might be a cause of,
Okay, very, very nice question. So for first question, in endophthalmitis putting oil, not every case, but most of the cases, because in my observation, I have seen if your endophthalmitis case is about 4 or 5 days, most of the cases are referred to me for the endophthalmitis from peripheral areas. So what I do usually, these retinas are fragile. These retina has a lot of issues with the micro punctures and even from the iatrogenic breaks and from the anti-site breaks. We may have incidence of retinal detachment later on. So these eyes are already fragile, already went under the surgery, complicated surgeries twice. So I don't want to take risk of the third surgery with the retinal detachment, because putting an oil may harm a little bit, but moving off the oil nowadays, it hardly takes 10 minutes and you have salvaged the eye from re-detachment. And most of the times, I think it's much usable rather than going for heroic attack acts that I am not using oil and not putting oil, but having a retinal detachment in post-endophthalmitis vitrectomy after 20 or 30 days, and that will be a disaster. And I don't like those eyes to operate, re-operate. For second question, yes, I do prefer to put a large bubble or small bubble, whatever you want, on the macula under the IOL before lifting the IOL, not to harm the IOL. But in these videos, unfortunately, I have done without it. But for the colleagues, I will preferably do to use the PFCL bubble, not to do this. With the experience, you can go on with it, but it's not even safe at that time. So it's better to use the PFCL bubble. I totally agree.
I have a question from Dr. Khakran. Don't you feel if you have a dropped IOL or a dropped nucleus, that this eye should be treated like a trauma eye, and if possible, the posterior hyoid should always be removed, because that decreases the incidence of long-term of possibility of retinal detachment, CME, and later on ERM formation. Something I like to do philosophically, routinely. And also a meticulous.
Dr. Shobhit, I totally agree with you. In the all the cases of IOL and nucleus drop.
No audio is coming.
Yeah.
Sorry.
I have a question for Mudit in a sense. There may be some cases where you may avoid doing a glued IOL. Are there any contraindications that you would like to re-emphasize to the audience? What are the
Yes, thank you, Dr. Aran. So, fibrin glue at this point of time, we believe will work more in uncomplicated simple RDs. In eyes which have got multiple breaks in multiple quadrants, it will be difficult to sequentially administer a thicker component, then go ahead and put a thin one. So we do not recommend doing it for RDs which have got number one extensive PVR changes. Number two, please remember this is not a substitute for scleral buckling. So if you have got a very anterior break, I would still recommend going and doing a scleral buckling and not a vitrectomy. So that is the first thing. Then, like I said, multiple breaks in multiple quadrants, again, a relative contraindication. And a third relative contraindication is a very large break. Any break larger than more than 2 disc diameter usually will have a risk of a more significant subretinal migration. So we don't want that to happen. So breaks larger than 2 disc diameter, very anterior breaks, multiple breaks in multiple quadrants are relative contraindications for this technique. At this point of time, we have found very good results in simple uncomplicated RDs with 1 or 2 breaks, maybe even 3 breaks localized within 1 to 2 clock hours or 3 clock hours within each other, but not multiple breaks in multiple quadrants.
Basically, I have also tried in glued RD surgery in 2010 also, but it failed in 3 of my successive cases. It failed because of multiple breaks in multiple quadrants. That was the main reason. Thank you for your nice presentation and your nice surgery, whatever results. And any other questions?
Ruchi, are we good to wind up? Do you think we can continue? Any audience questions?
I think audience don't have any other questions. Of course, in the chat box, they have not mentioned any questions.
Yes, I think we already answered the questions.
Yeah, thank you so much. Thank you on behalf of VRSI, yes, speakers, and Dr. Subhendu Boral, our moderator. Thank everyone for this wonderful session. And we hope to see you again virtually at the annual VRSI conference. Dr. Anand Rajendran will be sending out information to all of you very soon, and we all look forward to seeing you. Thank you all so much.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Anand.
Thank you, Dr. Rajendran, for joining in.